Next generation weather forecaster Joe Shocker here taking a look at Elsa and today's update for July 6, 2021. And this looks like this is going to be a very high impact storm from Florida right up to New England. We'll be taking a look at some modeling and walking through the whole process here. So let's start off with our visible satellite imagery here. You can see Elsa right over through here. You can definitely see it's an east-weighted storm, with most of the thunderstorm activity on the east side of center circulation. Some of it trying to get it closer and wrapping around the center, but with the west and southwesterly wind shear that we have coming up from the southwest, it's pushing these thunderstorms on the east side. But we'll see between now and as we head over the next, over the coming hours, as this continues to move off the north and paralleling the West Florida coast, if any of this can, really consolidate and get wrapped around the center and enhance her strength. So that's something that's kind of in question still at this time. But nevertheless, you can clearly see a half shredded, if you will, half put together tropical cyclone. Still winds roughly about 60 miles an hour in here, though. So this definitely is impactful. And of course, heavy weather, on the west coast of Florida throughout the day today. Here's the infrared. And again, you can see the nice deep cold cloud tops in through here being shown by those blacks and even a little bit of whites and there from time to time, so you can see there convection thunderstorm on the east side. And here, this actually shows up quite nicely here in the mid-levels. We do have some mid-level dry air, trying to somewhat get entrained, and that's why you don't have any convection on its west side as well. So you can see the mid-level dry air also being still a limiting factor, which is a good situation as we continue to move on down the road here. So the MGO, here we are, phase two, phase three, mulling around over there over the next few days as Elsa is tracking through the region. Now, MJO, phase two, phase three. Look at that. I don't know if I can zoom in on here. I don't want to mess up what I'm doing here, but phase two and phase three. Let me see here. I guess I can't zoom in on this. Let's see here. I do not have a zoom in tool, do I? I don't want to mess up what I'm doing here. Let's see. I'm just going to. Okay, it looks like I can zoom in just a little bit. I really want to zoom in on this. You can tell. Best I can here. But you can see here the enhancement off the west coast of Florida with some red showing up there. And then some additional enhancement from the Carolinas up to New England. So you can see the enhancement there. That looks pretty good. Let's see if I can go on to the next slide here. This is going to take a few seconds. Back out. Okay, it looks like I can back out. Okay, moving on to the next slide here. You can see the ocean temperatures here. I'll try not to zoom in again, but I really wanted to show that MJO correlation. But you can see the Gulf of Mexico here on the. Now, the better question is, where did my mouse go? And it looks like my mouse, batteries of my mouse just died. But nevertheless, you can see the ocean temperature anomalies off the west coast of Florida right there. Actually, there it is. My mouse is back. It is slightly cooler than normal, but that's not going to. It'll be a limiting factor, in my opinion. And then you can see once we get off the Carolina coastline all the way up to New England, ocean temperatures, SSTs, sea surface temperature anomalies, several degrees warmer than normal in Celsius. Now, what are the actual sea surface temperatures? So you can see here, 29 degrees Celsius off the Florida west coast. This is going to be inland, but still can pull in some of that more, tropical air off the waters. And then once it reemerges off the Carolinas, it's going to become a subtropical hybrid system. So it's going to take on the characteristics of a nor'easter, but still, again, wide temperatures in the low to mid 70s, pretty much all the way up to New England. So that is going to, certainly slow it down in its weakening process. But again, you're talking now jet stream energy getting involved. So it's going to be a different situation. And its energy source, it's not going to be 100% relied upon on the ocean heat. Nevertheless, again, here's the ocean heat content. You can see some pretty impressive values here up to the mid-Atlantic. And you can see the enhancement here on the in the Gulf of Mexico. We don't have any data for the west coast. Maybe the waters are just too shallow or for some reason it's not able to pick up on it. But there are values that are probably quite high along the shelf water there on the west coast of Florida. And then same thing here with how deep the water is. We don't have the data right along the coast, but you can see there's plenty of energy sitting out here for something like this to take advantage of. JMA, and I've been talking about this in the last couple of videos, the sinking motion that's in this part of the basin where Elsa is, I think is definitely limiting on how explosive that the storm system can get. You can, see that showing up quite nicely there in the vertical velocity at 200 millibars. And there's obviously the enhancement of the rain, and there's the trough split that's able to pull Elsa all the way up from the Carolinas to New England. First trough backs to the southwest, second trough comes in, mills around, tropical cyclone's there, and obviously it comes up like we're seeing now. Here's a tropical cyclone impact. You can pretty much see a 100% guarantee from Florida right to Cape Cod and likely into Atlantic Canada as we get towards the weekend. So very, very high probabilities as well. All right, so looking at the European ensemble, I mean, this is the 0Z run of the storm track. So you can see as it gets off the Mid-Atlantic coast, it's going to strengthen again as it's over that water and it's got those better jet dynamics. So these are the intensities and knots. The green lines are 40 to 50 knots. The yellow lines are 50 to 60 knots. And there's one member there that's 60 to 70 knots. But you can pretty much see here, mid-grade tropical system on a 0Z run. 6Z run, it's I'm trying to do the comparison between these. So it looks like the ensembles pretty much stay the course. If not, they're a little bit stronger. And at 60 row, it's some more members in the 50 to 60 knot than the 40 to 50 knot. But overall, it looks like it's the message is the same. And this is running up over southeastern New England during the day on Friday and quickly gone by time the weekend starts. But again, that's a pretty impressive look, you know, 50, 60 knots. Again, mid-grade, high-end, you know, tropical storm. I mean, certainly going to bring very, very impactful impacts, as you'll see here at the end. Here's the European operational. And you can see this is the 0Z run, the 6Z run, and it's pretty much the same from Weatherbell. It's the same idea, but you can see it's going to be a very small wind core, but because of the track of the storm, more than likely that this wind core is coming up over the Cape and Islands. You can see these are sustained winds and knots, upwards of 60 knots, and I verify that using the miles an hour from Weatherbell and, you know, high resolution, stepping out every 1 to 3 hours, that there could be even some 70 mph sustained winds within the small wind core. But let's not forget, you know, and, you know, not ignore, you know, this huge area of tropical storm force sustained winds, you know, pretty much 40 mph everywhere here in red. So that's a huge part. And again, you can see mainly on the eastern side as this thing comes up during the day on Friday. Then, of course, it's a 6-hourly snapshot. So you can see it goes from pretty much eastern, southeastern Long Island to the Gulf of Maine. So that brings it, obviously, you know, the high resolution European that's available at more frequent time stamps, you know, has that wind swath of 90 to 105 miles an hour over southeast New England and the Cape and the Islands. So that's a big concern. And it runs through that 60 to 70 mile per hour sustained wind swath right through the Cape and Islands as well. So here is my official wind gust forecast for Elsa. Again, here is the Elsa track. I have it going right up the southeast mass. Using the European ensemble data the best, I think it's got the best handle on the nature of the system. So I did that, did some adjustments. But overall, you can see not much wind. And this is a classic, you know, transition situation where you got very heavy rain on the north and west side, and then the strongest winds on the south and east side. So you can see the track roughly over southeast mass, possibly coming to Plymouth County, you know, and then I believe this is Barnstable County, but nevertheless, coming up right through Narragansett Bay here, then exiting like that into the Gulf of Maine. But small quarter of strong damaging wind gusts in Plymouth County, roughly, and then the hurricane force wind gusts confined here pretty much to the Cape. Once you cross the Bourne and Sagamore Bridge here that leads onto the Cape, this is where I think the highest probability of hurricane and, you know, wind gusts possibly 90 to 100 miles an hour are currently going to be at this time. Now, if this track shifts a little further, you know, south and east, then these wind gusts come down. If it shifts a little bit further north and west, the wind gusts can expand further into southern New England, or we could just be dealing with a weaker system overall, which means these wind gust members, I know what you see here, these members of wind gust, yeah, what I have for numbers, can come down. So that's something I'm still working on, and we'll see how exactly this unfolds. But this is, I think, a first good stab at what I think is going to be the outcome. And then here's just a larger track of that as well. You can see 60, 65 mile per hour storm throughout the day today into tomorrow, and then weakening, obviously coming over land, and then getting another boost once it reemerges off the Mid-Atlantic coast, and again coming across southeast New England Friday afternoon. I think it's a 65 mile per hour hybrid storm, not purely tropical hybrid, and then exiting up into the Gulf of Maine, and then likely impacts into Atlantic Canada as we get into Friday night and into the first half of the weekend. So that is my update for now. We'll certainly see how this goes down, but certainly a very, very interesting and a pretty unusual situation as well to have a possible landfall here in southern New England. So that's it for now, and thank you for watching.